from Moscow, he's professor and head of inflammation research at the Institute of Molecular Medicine and associate consultant at the Department of Clinical Biochemistry and Pharmacology. He's also chair of one of the chairs in health science at the Danish IAS, and has a long list of achievements which I will spare you because you can read it on our webpage. But actually, today is going to give one of the lectures of the Danish IAS on the development of antibody drugs from molecular discovery to animal. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Francisco. Yeah, I'm going to give a talk about NASH. Everyone is talking about NASH nowadays. So am I?
That's right, he's sitting all there.
That's my surname. Yeah, okay. Really? Happy time. Great. But I'll not talk about you. Okay, nice to see a filled room here. I know you are not medics, all of you, so I will introduce you also to the field also so Francisco and Torbjørn, the head of YES, have a chance to understand what I'm saying. I am from another part of the university here, close to the hospital that we have molecular medicine. Here's a building we have to leave in 2022, I think the plan is. But it's a nice building with nice facilities with several groups in under molecular medicine. I'm heading the section of inflammation, and inflammation is what we are going to talk about today when we talk about NASH. Inflammation is condition you have when you have these symptoms: heat, redness, swelling, pain, and also loss of function. Inflammation can be induced by infection. It's what most people know, but it can also be caused by toxic or trauma or immunological reaction. You don't need to have an infection. So you can have a sterile inflammation without infection. That's important. So a lot of chronic inflammation, for instance, arthritis, neuroinflammation, and so on, is without infection. You have increased blood flow. This leads to swelling, to heat, to redness, and also to pain, and also to loss of function. So these are explain the symptoms here when you have inflammation. Normally you have restored the condition and you get back to normal condition, but if it's a very serious inflammation, you can have collagen deposition and so on, and have the condition called fibrosis. And then you have irreversible loss of function. So the best is that we can treat an inflammation before we get to this stage. And when we are talking the medical language, then we use the itis. When we have an inflammation, and you have heard about appendicitis, bronchitis, colitis, and so on. So this is the name for infection or inflammation in a different organ. What we're going to talk about is hepatitis, and we're going to talk about the non-infectious type of hepatitis, and it's a form called steatohepatitis. Steato means that you have fat in the liver and an inflammation. Here's a steatohepatitis in the liver. It's a microscopic picture with a special staining, with, for instance, same for fibrosis. You see the green here, but you also see a lot of fat droplet. And if you know the architecture of a normal liver, you can see there's a complete loss of normal architecture in this. This is a normal liver, where you see the parenchymal cells, the hepatocytes here. Also important to note, there are other cell types, as the so-called macrophages called Kupffer cells. They're stained by iron staining here. They are localized close to the blood. The liver is a very perfused organ, where you have all cells exposed to the circulation, including the hepatocytes and the macrophages. There are also other cells, we are not going to talk about them, so-called stellate cells and ciliate cells, but we are going to talk about the Kupffer cells, the macrophages of the liver, when we talk about NASH. And why are we talking about, why so much talk about NASH? It's because it's a condition where you see more and more diseased people with this disease. And it relates to obesity. When you compare it with diseases in different organs, for instance, cardiovascular diseases, diabetes and so on, and look over time, you have a decrease in mortality. We are better and better in treating the patients. But one exception is liver diseases. Here you see a steady increase in mortality, and there's no real good treatment. So when we're talking about steatohepatitis, most people think about it as NASH, which means non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. But there's also another form called alcoholic steatohepatitis, shortened AH. And I would say a few words about these two conditions, which are very similar. First, about the acute alcoholic hepatitis. In the alcoholic liver disease, you have different stages. Initially, you get the steatosis, meaning you have the fatty liver. Later on, when you get inflammation and so on, you might have fibrosis. Later on, you can have cirrhosis, and later you can get a carcinoma, a cancer in the liver. It's not the case for all, but the risk increases for having fibrosis, for instance, when you have the steatosis and so on, you have increased risk of getting the more serious conditions. There are many risk factors to have the alcoholic liver diseases. In addition, of course, you have to drink. But if you're a female, if you're obese, or you have a you don't eat much and so on, you have an increased risk of getting the disease. There's also a comorbidity, meaning that if you have another disease, you have an increased risk. For instance, if you have a viral hepatitis, you might have an increased risk of getting alcoholic liver disease. And then the inflammation you might not have here, for instance, when you have the steatosis. But then you can have an inflammatory reaction, and it can actually happen in any states where you get a very serious inflammation. I don't know if you've ever seen people that are alcoholics, they can suddenly be very yellow, they get what we call jaundice, they have a very yellow skin, and it's because the liver doesn't work properly. And it's because they have the acute alcoholic hepatitis. And it might happen to people that are otherwise, they don't look diseased, they drink too much and so on, then suddenly they get this hepatitis and they get seriously ill, the mortality is actually up to 30-40%, and there's no real good treatment. And what's happening is not completely known, but we know that the macrophages are important. I'll not go into the deep details for all the hypotheses and so on, but just mention here that one thing that seems to be important is that from the bacteria in the in the gut, we can have some leakage into the circulation, and bacteria that have the so-called endotoxin called LPS, lipopolysaccharide, and it can activate a receptor called TLR4 in the macrophages, leading to a so-called cytokine storm, and then you attract immune cells and other macrophages and so on, and then you have the serious inflammation. Then a few words about the non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. And it's actually the picture I showed you before. Here's a person with a non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, a very obese person who has a lot of fat accumulating in the liver. The early stages is it's called non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. When you then have the inflammation on top of the accumulation of fat, then you have what we call NASH, non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. And if it continues, then you have the cirrhosis, and then you are in real problem, because then you have an incomplete liver function, and if it's really serious, you might die of that condition. And the pathogenesis in NASH is probably very similar to that of alcoholic liver disease. Again, the macrophages are important. We know that there's a constant exposure of the macrophages to LPS from few macrophages, bacteria leaking into the circulation. Normally we can control that, but if we have a fat accumulation and high fat production in the liver, then there is also a stimulation of the macrophages, and then you might induce an inflammatory state, not as acute as in the alcoholic liver disease, but anyway an inflammation, and then you have the NASH condition. And if it continues for long, then you get the fibrotic state and get very diseased. And of course, we have an epidemic condition worldwide with obesity, so we also have a high increase of high increase in incidence of NASH. Also, I show that important that there are things that might further stimulate NASH, and there's a focus now also on the sugar we eat, and it seems that fructose in particular is toxic to the liver. Because it's a sugar, but also because it has some special effects on the liver. Fructose is almost exclusively metabolized in the liver. If we are in a state where we really need sugar, we might metabolize a bit in the non-liver organs, but if we have food enough, then the fructose is only metabolized in the liver. And here, most of it is transformed into lipids, so the fructose become lipids in the liver, and then it can accumulate. In addition, it might have toxic effects on the liver, but here the details are not that well known. And fructose is actually a very common component when you drink a Coke, for instance, half a liter of Coke, about 35 pills of sugar in it, and you know it's sucrose, and sucrose is a disaccharide, where half it is fructose and the other half is glucose. So you get a lot of fructose when you just drink a Coke. And what is that? Most people know that, but what many don't know is that fructose is also added as pure fructose in a lot of food components. And it's because you can produce it from corn very cheap, and fructose is a very good sugar in terms of taste. You really you can have a sugar, so-called sugar index, and it scores very high. It should be a bit higher than sucrose. So the sweetening of fructose is very, very good. In addition, it enhances the taste of other components. So if you, for instance, add it to ketchup, then you will have a more or stronger taste if you have fructose at the same time. Many people don't think about that this is a good taste because it has sugar at the same time. So it's a way we get a lot of sugar in our food. Now to a bit about our science. I know we're working different fields, but I'll now tell you a story where we have tried to treat animals where we have induced NASH by using fructose. And we have made a drug which is an antibody linked to an anti-inflammatory drug. And this antibody recognizes this molecule CD163, which is only expressed in macrophages, including Kupffer cells in the liver. Half of the macrophages in the bodies are in fact Kupffer cells, so by making this drug conjugate, we can target very effectively the liver. I'll show you the main persons here. It's Jonas Graversen, who's associate professor at the department, and Pia Nielsen, who has been here. She's now in Aarhus, but she was the first author on this study, published Christmas Eve last year. I don't know if you remember the day. But a few words about CD163. It's a receptor scavenging hemoglobin in complex with a protein called haptoglobin. It was a discovery we made when I worked in Aarhus. And it was it's expressed only in macrophages, and we discovered it to be a receptor for hemoglobin when it's released from the red cells. It happens when you have a hemolysis in the blood. For instance, it can happen during a blood transfusion, it can happen during malaria infection, many other conditions. Can be very serious conditions because hemoglobin is very oxidative and it can damage tissue. So there has to be a scavenging system. Fortunately, in blood we have haptoglobin, and it makes a complex which is recognized by this receptor, and then we have degradation of the complex, and here we have and leads to production of this yellow substance bilirubin, and it's actually the one that makes the skin yellow when you have jaundice, because it accumulates in the liver, or it can't be metabolized. So this yeah, later on we discovered the structure. If you're interested, then that's a paper on the structure of this complex. But it's not the story I'm going to tell about. So this clearance of hemoglobin is in parallel to the clearance of red blood cells. They survive for 120 days, and then they are removed by the macrophages that recognize the red cells. So this mechanism, together with the one we disclosed, is essential for removal of hemoglobin. We have about 0.5 to 1 kilo of hemoglobin, so it's a very important clearance mechanism. And it only happens in macrophages.
So, when you did these studies, were actually vivo? Were on a specific part of the liver, or how did you actually like that this is actually what happens in a person? Just to understand.
The way we identified this was it was well known that hemoglobin is there's a clearance of it in macrophages, so it was well known from animals, but also people from humans. The way we identified it was by so-called affinity construct, where we made these complexes of haptoglobin and hemoglobin, made columns and purified a receptor. At that time, we didn't know what the protein was, but then it was actually together with the mass spec people here. And Odense disclosed to be CD163, and then it opened up the field. So it was basic molecular biology, I would say, that led to that discovery. But it's another story. But we then knew that this receptor is highly expressed in macrophages. It's a receptor for endocytosis, so it's transport into the cell, and it's only expressed in macrophages. So it was a good target for targeting macrophages, and we have then made complexes of antibodies and drug in order to see can we make a more precise medicine for diseases where we only want to target the macrophages. And the complex we have worked a lot on is a complex between an antibody against CD163, and then linked to glucocorticoids. Glucocorticoids are, you may know them as steroids, also not the anabolic steroids, but the steroids you use for treatment of inflammation. And we have used a synthetic one, which is called dexamethasone. And we can, on average, link four of these drugs to an antibody. These glucocorticoids, binyrebarkhormoner, they are well known for a lot of side effects. They are the most potent anti-inflammatory drugs you have, but they cause a lot of side effects, osteoporosis, immunosuppression, and also lead to diabetes, CNS disturbances, skin atrophy, hormonal disturbances, and there are a lot of problems with these drugs. So their use is really regulated. So our intention was if we could target only to macrophages, then we could reduce the dose and avoid these side effects. And this is just to show that the liver, in fact, express a lot of CD163. Here we have stained the macrophages, the antibody, actually one of them we have used for drug conjugation. You see them here in the liver. This is another macrophage antibody showing a similar staining. And actually, if you look in the alcoholic steatohepatitis, you have much more staining. And it's because when you have the inflammation, then you attract more macrophages and you also increase the expression of CD163. So therefore, steatohepatitis is an obvious model. Before we started the experiment on steatohepatitis, we made some studies in rats and pigs where we just induced inflammation with endotoxin. So we injected endotoxin, and prior to that we tried to inject our drug component to see if there's any anti-inflammatory effect. It's a very common and very simple model in animals. So we did that both in rats and in pigs. I'm not going to show you all the data, they are published, but the effect in rats, when you inject the LPS, you see a high increase in cytokines, for instance, that one called TNF and tumor necrosis factor and interleukin 1. Here you see the increase when you just have injected a PS without injecting anything prior than PBS. When we then have treated them with our drug conjugate, you see a complete reduction in the cytokine secretion. When we use the drug in the same amount, or the effective drug component, the dexamethasone, in the same amount, you see no effect. Actually, we need a much higher concentration of the free form, 50 times higher, to get close to the reduction we see. We also made those dependence curves that indicate that the efficacy was increased 50 times when we made this conjugate in terms of anti-inflammatory effects. And side effects was, and we did that both in rats and pigs, and we measured also some of the adverse effects. And actually we could see that with our drug we had very little adverse effect. We have measured here the suppression of the endogenous production of glucocorticoids. When you make an injection with synthetic glucocorticoid, you suppress your production of glucocorticoid, it's cortisol, and the releasing or the stimulating hormone from the pituitary gland. You see here the suppression, but with our drug conjugate, we see no suppression. This is one of the common ways to measure adverse effects. We also measured other adverse effects, and we didn't see anything. So this was very promising. And now to the NASH study. It was done in rats, and we induced the NASH with fructose. And it was very effective. In 12 weeks, we saw a very strong fat accumulation, and you also see signs of fibrosis here. So it was a very effective model for studying NASH. You can also see there was accumulation of macrophages here. We have stain for CD123 in the liver, and you see macrophages here, highly expressing for CD123. It was already after 2 months. We also tried to target, see for targeting of our conjugate. Here we have injected it to rat, and then we have looked for uptake in the liver. Actually, it's a whole liver section you see here, and you only see the macrophages lighting up here with the drug. When we look at a higher scale, higher magnification, we see that the uptake is in vesicles. It's in accordance with the uptake by the supramedullary oxytocins. So this was very promising, and here is the first study we did in the NASH rats, where we started fructose treatment here, and then we had a fructose feeding, and then we have 9 series of treatment with our conjugate and 3 dexamethasone and a conjugate where we used a control antibody. Then a lot of different endpoints that I used in studying of NASH. For instance, you can measure liver enzymes and so on that tells something about the liver function. But here the most important and illustrative findings. Here we have see a normal liver. Here is a fructose-induced NASH, where we just had treated with vehicle. And here we have treated with anti-CD163 dexamethasone conjugate. We still see some NASH, but it's much reduced compared to when we just treat with vehicle. And if we treat just with dexamethasone, we actually see an increase in NASH in accordance with the side effects of using dexamethasone. But when we make it as a conjugate, we see a very positive effect. There's no effect, reducing effect on NASH with the controlled conjugate. And here it's measured, where you can actually measure the so-called NASH score, like I explained in detail how we're doing this. But when you do that, you see a clear reduction in the NASH score with our conjugate, where we have no significant effect with our controls. Actually, we see almost similar data just by measuring the liver weight, which is an indication that you have less fat accumulation in the liver, but also less inflammation.
A question?
Yeah.
I understand the objectiveness of measuring or chemical composition, but if you go on back to analyze the images as well, do you have objective measures from those? Clearly there are some patterns, but can you see which ones are the most?
Yeah, you can. There is a software you can measure.
Where you analyze
how
much
you can
area
you can get
is
it, transform it into a quantitative
measure.
Yes. And we have measured a lot of how clinical parameters in the blood you can measure enzymes and so on. And here we also see a normalization of the condition. Not completely, but much better. But also we only treat it for 3 weeks in this mice. For instance, the triglycerides is highly increased in NASH, normalized with our treatment. We also made an analysis of selected genes where we, by RT-PCR, measured RNA. And we also saw a high degree of normalization. I'm not going to detail on that. But the conclusion is that selective targeting of low dose glucocorticoid to CD163 positive macrophages by this ADC technology, it means antibody-drug conjugate using CD163 as target receptor, is a novel and promising approach for treatment of NASH. Furthermore, owing to the macrophage-specific expression of CD163, this proves a key role of macrophages in NASH pathogenesis. But this technology might also be used for alcoholic hepatitis and also other inflammatory diseases where the macrophage activity is important, and such studies are underway. Yes, and then I would just mention that we now have been lucky to have this Atlas initiative funded. It's a center for functional genomics and tissue plasticity headed by Susanne Mandrup. But here we are going to study obesity, and a big part of that will be related to NASH. Also, when we're going to study different models, Kiel, who's here, is a liver specialist, is going to work also on this, and Jonas Graversen and Alexander Krav, who's a clinician. And here we'll be able to measure, to see changes in the single cells, in the hepatocytes, and macrophages, and stellate cells during NASH diseases. So we're going to work on NASH in different models. We know the fructose models, but there are other ways to induce similar liver disease. And it's something we're going to start. Okay, then we have some time for questions. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, so I already asked for questions, so have any questions?
Very nice. So I noticed that when you treat with the antibody drug conjugate, you also see a decrease in lipid accumulation in the liver.
Yeah.
So is that removed before you see approval of NASH, or is it a consequence of the improvement? You know, when
Yeah. It's a very good question. It's probably not a direct effect of our antibody, because it only hits the macrophages. But the inflammation as such has a negative effect on the hepatocytes, so they become diseased, so to say, and accumulate fat, or at least they can't excrete the fat as fast as they normally do. So there's an interesting communication between the macrophages and the hepatocytes that has a negative influence on the hepatocytes. And it's something we would like to work on in Atlas also.
So
to try to explain this communication a bit.
So is the mechanism known how the lipids then are removed when you improve the NASH?
Mm.
Is it by a traditional heat oxidation, or is it by lipophagy, or?
You have a lot of secretion. So the best would just to secrete it as an ideal one. All that, and then send it for deposition in the liver. You shouldn't expect it to be oxidized and metabolized, because you have a constant metabolism in the liver, and you can't really increase that.
Other questions?
I have one question. So very.
You should know everything.
Well, no, I still have questions. Still black holes here and there.
You can tell the advantage.
I was curious about, so one challenge is, of course, with these patients that you discover them too late. It's diagnosed too late once they. I'm not a clinician, but like that's sort of when you see them, when the liver stops functioning.
Yeah.
So in your model, you started your treatment with the conjugate already after 3 weeks of. Like after you
yeah,
start,
yeah. We have many speculation. When is the What is the right dose? What is the right interval? When should we treat and so on?
So could you start so like how late you can actually start the treatment and still be able to reverse the phenotype?
We have not done that yet. But I would expect that we could see some effect, but of course it's something we have to show.
And does it reoccur, after treatment? If you stop treatment, does the NASH reoccur?
We have not. We terminated the stop because we wanted to examine the liver and so on, but of course it's...
Just a question. It's probably not ethical to do this, but it's still a question of what would happen if you did this on a continued basis to healthy people? The normal functioning of the macrophage.
It's an ethical problem because you know, glucocorticoids. It's a
there's a lot of changes on this drug.
So this should be used as a preventive.
Maybe I should rephrase my question. What's the consequence of not having the macrophage for a healthy person? Or not having the macrophage function. I mean, it must be doing something. The macrophages must be doing something.
Yeah. So you ask if there's a side effect of reducing function of the macrophage.
Yeah.
We are not killing the macrophages. They're still functioning. They're still endocytosing, and they're secreting a lot of things. We are just reducing the cytokine storm.
Yeah.
But of course, there might be some effects that are needed. And for instance, if you we reduce the production of TNF, and one of the side effects of using anti-TNF, specific anti-TNF treatment, is that during increases the risk of tuberculosis. So there might be, for instance, some infections you easier get if you're under long treatment of this.
Okay, yeah.
we can't exclude that because, of course, we hit all the macrophages in the entire body, also in the lung. And so, but the basic function, for instance, the clearance of hemoglobin, I would expect that to be unaltered.
I was just wondering, so the positive effect is that when the mice continue on high fructose, or do they switch to a normal, so it's the classic drug and dietary changes, or can you keep stuffing yourself with high fructose and that this eventually turns into a drug, then that will mitigate the effect?
I don't understand.
So is it, do the mice continue to eat high fructose diet when you treat them?
Yeah.
So it's a positive effect, even if you keep stopping yourself with.
Yeah.
Okay.
But rats.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it's nice to know. You don't have to change your diet.
No.
There's a pill coming.
Exactly. I had a similar question because you focus here on drugs, but if you take a step back, there is the whole mapping out all these mechanisms. So what will be the most important implications? Will you just find drugs for our misbehaving, or will there be policies preventing us from catching these diseases in the long run as we understand the mechanisms better?
Yeah, we'll work on the mechanism, we'll work on drugs to treat. At the same time, it's important to prevent that you get this condition.
We're not providing coke here, we go upstairs.
But you might get into condition where you have so serious inflammation, so you have to treat inflammation. And when you're treating inflammation, you change your diet.
But treating people is costly. Maybe we should prevent people from getting obese in the first place. So as we understand,
absolutely. And if you stop drinking, and if you start
thinking GDP, you can get drunk. And
what we really like, you know, is actually to treat people with acute alcoholic hepatitis, because there you have people that are really diseased. They have a mortality of 30-40%. So if you can treat them with this medical treatment, and then tell them stop drinking and change lifestyle.
It's a life-changing experience to be near them.
But I completely agree. The best thing with that we don't get the last disease.
Yeah.
I'm asking a slightly different direction.
Yeah, yeah.
So of course you're interested in treating humans, but. Could you imagine applications in other areas, like personally, foie gras production? What am I saying? Foie gras?
Yeah, foie gras.
There we go. No. But there is food upstairs, and you're. It's up to you whether you want to drink a Coke or not. So we want to stop you, but we want to thank again, Søren, for